Hey guys, welcome back to another video. So for the longest time, I've been talking more about getting into longer distance shooting. I've been shooting the ACOG a lot on my M16A4 clone, which I love and will continue to do. But I always want to get more into the, you know, the LPVO, MPVO kind of game instead. And so I finally did it. I actually bought an MPVO, the Primary Arms 3-18x44 first focal plane optic, their GLx series, and I stuck it on my M4A1 clone. And so I've only shot about 200 rounds or so through the MPVO, so I can't really give any kind of informed review. So I'm just using this video to just share the latest build, basically, just for fun. I also took a little bit of a break shooting the M4 because, you know, I just wanted to use different guns. But, you know, even then, I'd always wanted to come back to taking the M4A1 clone out of the safe. And, you know, this was the perfect opportunity to do it. Now, I know the 14.5-inch barrel works just fine. Yes, there are, like, on paper, better and longer barrel lengths to use. But it's a great excuse to use the MPVO and also to get back to shooting the M4 clone. And so let's hop right into it. So a brief background on the M4A1 clone. This is a Daniel Defense, well, M4A1. And then I just changed out some of the parts to make it look a little more like the Block 2 clone. All just for the aesthetic purposes. There's never actually been anything wrong with the rifle. I just wanted it to look a certain way. So that's why you'll see the pieces you see on here. So starting with the optic, as I mentioned, this is the Primary Arms 3-18x44 first focal plane reticle, and it comes with the Athena reticle specifically in mil dots or in mils or whatever. And so I've been liking it a lot so far. Again, I can't really give a hugely informed opinion on it because I have such a little trigger time behind it. But initial impressions, I would say the construction is very good. It feels very sturdy and I'm not worried about parts breaking. The glass clarity seems very good, or at least for me. If I consider it, you know, with my ACOG, I don't notice a big difference, which is good. Maybe side to side, if I compared them at the same time, I would, but you know, I think the glass clarity is great. I also find the reticle to be intuitive to use. I'm just used to using chevrons, and so, which is what the MPVO here uses. So it's been pretty great. I will say one thing is that, you know, I understand, you know, kind of the tier of optic that I got, but I wish that the turrets, even though they have auto-locking features, so I'm never worried about accidentally adjusting my reticle, I wish that the, you know, the engagement or the clicks between turns were a little more positive and tactile, but, you know, I'm always aware of what I'm dialing and such. So it's more just like something I've noticed, but I don't think it's, you know, any kind of deal breaker in any way whatsoever. Otherwise, it has the usual features, adjustable for windage and elevation. It also has, you know, illumination, which is great, which I haven't used like a ton because I just shoot in daytime. And then it also has a parallax adjustment as well, which I'm still kind of getting used to how to use, but I think I understand it overall. Definitely very helpful as well. I would eventually like to put a piggyback red dot on it. I have a holosun sitting in the safe, and so I'm just waiting for the mount itself to come through. And I think that'll like kind of help me a lot in terms of, you know, making this optic or making this rifle not just long range only, but obviously still a long range focused kind of gun. Also, because this MPVO is a variable power scope, it does come with an integrated throw lever on it. I didn't have to buy it separately, which is quite nice. And so while you definitely don't need the throw lever in order to change the magnification, I will say it does help a lot, so you know, that's an extra bonus there too. And all of this is sitting on one of the Primary Arms, I think it's the PLX cantilever mount. I got the 20 MOA version. Will I really need 20 MOA versus zero? Probably not, but you know, I got it. It was actually the same price, and so you know, why not? Now let's move forward on the gun to the muzzle end of things. I have the Surefire War Comp, which I like a lot. It's been great to help with recoil, and I had this before I actually put on the MPVO when I was using the Aimpoint, the Comp M4S, and it's timed for a right-hand shooting, so I do like it a lot. But as you can tell, it kind of blasts a lot of that gunk onto the Surefire 640, you know, the light that I have on here as well. It doesn't impact the performance or anything of the light. One thing I will note is that the tines on the War Comp do ring a decent amount. I don't care, and I don't think this matters. I actually think it's kind of cool. So I'll throw in some footage of what that sounds like just so you can get a feel for it. Now Now for me, as I just said, it's not really that big of a deal, but I can tell some people don't like it, at least skimming, you know, like Reddit or YouTube or whatever. Some people don't like that ringing sound, but you know, just there, food for thought in case you're considering buying one. But it's been great, it's helped a lot for recoil as well. I mentioned the light on here is the Surefire 640U, and I've had this one for a while and it's held up great, and yeah, so it's there, it works fine. Not much to say. And then we also have the nice armor mount M4 front sight in taupe, you know, whichever one's closest to flat dark earth. I'm kind of going back and forth between whether I want my backup iron sights, especially if I already have, you know, already plan to put the hollow sight on top of the MPVO. And so on one hand, I'm going back and forth between like, you know, I don't need all the stuff on it, it'll save on weight, even if it's a few ounces. But on the other hand, to be really honest, I paid a decent amount of money for it, and so, you know, I kind of want to get my money's worth, even if I know I will never need it. Like, especially the backup sight, in order to use it, I need to unscrew the MPVO because it's not on a QD mount, and that's also assuming if my red dot mount on the MPVO doesn't work. So realistically, will I ever use these? No, I won't. But it looks kind of cool, so, you know, I'll probably keep it for now, but we'll see. You know, I think there's something we all know, but we don't always say, is that we always talk about final builds or something. But in reality, that's never the case. I've gone back and forth to changing so many parts in this gun and others, and these folding backup sights are probably the same deal. Now, obviously here at the front end, besides the light and also the war comp, we also have the bipod. And so I went with a Harris bipod because it seems to be very popular. And I specifically chose this one because it has the, you know, it's Picatinny compatible, then it also has a little more abilities to kind of adjust it on the fly. So particularly the legs of the bipod, you can, you know, you can adjust them. They have the notches here, and then also it allows the bipod to actually like tilt, swivel or whatever, so I can make some adjustments as well. And so I've been liking this one so far as well. It's been great and very sturdy. And yeah, I don't really have any complaints or anything positive. Again, it's only been 200 rounds through this rifle in this configuration, so I'm still kind of testing it out. This bipod in particular is the 6-9 inch one. The way that I decided between the 6-9 and there's like a 9-11 or 12 inch, there's like a, you know, a bigger bipod out there. The way I suggest you go about doing that is like, if you're shooting off, you know, any kind of sandbag right now, you don't have a bipod. I basically measured the height of the sandbags that I used to shoot off with, and then kind of saw, like, I think mine was 5 inches or whatever. I realized it was always a little too low and I always had to adjust. So I decided I'd just get the 6-9. And then I just realized probably that, like, you know, the top range of that 6-9, the 9-inch height adjustment, is probably way more than I would need. So there was no need for me to get anything bigger. So that's kind of how I made that decision of which one to get. One thing I'm also noticing using the Harris bipod too is that even if it provides a lot of stability up front, I still do like having that rear sandbag to kind of brace against my shoulder because it makes things even sturdier. Now, this seems to be pretty common knowledge, but it's something I'm still learning. So, you know, if you ever do get a bipod or some kind of front support, don't forget that rear bag as well to help you. Otherwise, we can start moving back towards the rear of the rifle, and really there haven't been any changes here since I had the Comp M4S on here. So again, I have, you know, the Knight's Armament rear sight, which is the 200 to 600 meter, which I never use but looks cool. The charging handle I have on here is the PRI Gasbuster M84, the military big latch, and so I had this on here before I even had the MPVO, but now I find it really is a necessity. Based on where the MPVO is sitting, it's as far forward as possible to have good eye relief, but to the point where it's not bridging or, you know, the optic mount isn't starting to attach to the rail as well. Like, you don't want to bridge your optic, right, for stability reasons. And so the optic, you know, positioning on the rifle is kind of fixed and it has to be here unless I got a whole nother mount, which I don't want to do. And so because of where it is, it kind of interferes with the charging handle if you were to use like a, you know, a non-extended latch. So I have this military big latch charging handle on here, which really helps me to be able to use and get that proper reach. And then moving along to the trigger and the pistol grip, right now I just have the basic plain Jane mil-spec trigger in here as well. Eventually I would like to get a two-stage trigger, which I've shot before on other guns, and I do understand the benefit of those. Those are very nice and I do want one eventually. But for now, you know, I'm thinking I just need to prioritize getting the fundamentals and understanding my rifle and how to just even shoot at longer distances. I need those techniques first before I start throwing even more money into this build than I have already. And the grip on here that I have is the A2 pistol grip, you know, your standard one, which is surprisingly controversial, I didn't think. When I bought this rifle from the factory, it had Daniel Defense's, you know, Daniel Defense pistol grip. But I didn't actually really like the, didn't like Daniel Defense's pistol grip because I felt the rubber was not tactile, but I would always have my grip slip. And so having the A2 pistol grip was, you know, one, you know, checks the box of the clone stuff, but also I actually like it a lot, and so it works well for me, so I'm sticking with it. And then last but certainly not least, on the buttstock, we have the B5 SOP mod enhanced, I think it is. Not the Bravo, which is the smaller one, but the big boy that has the two, you know, kind of battery or, you know, two tubular compartments on there. I really like this buttstock. I also have it on my Mark 18 clone as well. I think it's a beefy stock and also gives you a good cheek weld, but it's not like overly big and, you know, too chunky. So that completes the parts list and kind of the build of the rifle. Overall, I'd say I'm, you know, really enjoying shooting at longer distances. I don't always get an opportunity to use the ranges that I want because of weather. Sometimes it gets closed or just other people take it and there's only one. But in the meantime, I've basically been practicing at 100 yards, making sure I can really lock in on the fundamentals and, you know, just getting used to the scope overall. You know, I'm still trying to figure out what's the sweet spot between do I, you know, go max magnification but also have a really unforgiving eye box, or do I kind of, you know, dial it back a bit? You know, my target is less magnified, but it's much more forgiving on, you know, eye relief, which I'm leaning towards. Parallax adjustment, I think I get that overall. One thing I'm also trying to learn for shooting while standing with a bipod is kind of just like how to position my arms. Like if I'm shooting off a barrel like I have here in this clip, I was kind of learning between, do I want to actually use my support hand to keep the bipod stable, or do I want to put a rear bag against my shoulder and hold it there? So just things like that, I'm still learning and still getting used to, but I'm definitely having a blast doing it, and it's been a lot of fun. I kind of shelved this rifle for a bit and started to use my Mark 18 clone, the SBR, which I still love, but I've just always gravitated towards this larger, like the 14.5 build. And so this was a great excuse to get it back out on the field. By the field, I mean the range and the weekends, you know. And so it's been really fun and I've enjoyed it a lot. And so I just wanted to share this with you guys. Definitely as I get more trigger time behind this and I actually get to push this rifle out to further distances, I'll definitely keep you guys updated on how it goes and also just talk more about longevity and my experiences from like a product review standpoint on how I feel like the MPVO is stacking up to. And so yeah, that's really about it. Just wanted to share the latest build that I have. Again, the iteration of my M4 has changed for the millionth time, but I'm loving it, having fun with it. And so I'll keep you guys updated on how the scope is going and just, you know, take you along as I shoot. And so thanks for joining. Let me know if you have any tips from anything you've noticed in me shooting, you know, with the scope and with the bipod. I will catch you guys in the next one.